Chapter 11 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 11. Other Lives. It was a long time before Wilmot Armstrong could persuade his old chum to leave his solitude in those quiet rooms by the river and share in the various distractions which London offers to unencumbered youth. Theatres, music halls, suburban race meetings, boating excursions on the upper reaches of the Thames, quiet little dinners at Greenwich with an after-dinner cigar in the summer gloaming. Wilmot had come back to his native country with a keen appetite for all these pleasures, and he wanted his old friend to join in them. But it was only after his interview with Mary Freeland that Arnold shook off his gloomy spirits and consented to do a round of the theatres, and to take a weekend holiday at Maidenhead. There was indeed no reason that two idle men should choose the end of the week, when all the hard workers were crowding the riverside hotels, save to escape from the horror of those London Sundays which had weighed heavily on Arnold's dejected spirits. I felt so wretched all the week that nobody would suppose Sunday could add a darker shade to my misery, he told Wilmot. But it did. When I woke in the grey morning and heard the bells ringing for an early service, I just turned my face to the wall and groaned aloud, as if I had been Job. "But you're as right as the mail now, old chap," replied Wilmot. "You've cheered up wonderfully during this last week, just as I was beginning to doubt the agreeable influence of my society." "Your society has been the saving of me, Will." "Ah, but there has been something else. The cure was sudden." Yes, the cure had been wrought by a look from a woman's truthful eyes, the confiding pressure of a woman's hand, a look and a touch that told him he was loved, that however hardly Mary Freeland had used him on that bitter day of his release, she was now his to claim when he would. She would wait for him, he thought, wait and go on loving him, even if it cost him years to take the stain from his character. Here was a case in which a girl might fairly be asked to wait for her lover. She was rich and could live her own life. She was not pining in poverty, dying in the dullness of a rural vicarage, worried by anxious parents, a drudge for younger brothers and sisters. Life had laid itself out very pleasantly for Mary Freeland. The fragment of essay or speech found in the lodging-house had not been traced to its source, in spite of Faunce's efforts. He had enlisted the sub-editor and reporters of a city paper in the search, but the most careful examination of files of newspapers had been barren of result. Faunce's friend, the sub-editor, opined that the fragment was part of a lecture. The few sentences had the bluntness and strong ring of language intended for oral delivery. "The man who wrote these lines is a socialist, but not a member of the working classes," said the editor. "I'm afraid we must give it up, Faunce. There are hundreds of socialist lectures delivered in London that never see print, and any number of meetings that are not reported by so much as a paragraph. I've had all the popular daily papers of November and December gone through for any mention of a lecture likely to include those lines, without result." Arnold groaned aloud when Faunce repeated these words of the editor's. He had a copy of the fragment in his pocket-book. He knew the strong, rough-hewn phrases by heart, and it seemed to him a hard thing that the highly trained criminal investigator could fail to find the man whose hand had written those words. Faunce smiled at his impatience. "The words may never have been spoken in public," he said. "Who knows? The sentences may have been jotted down at random while the thought was red-hot. A shorthand writer has a tremendous advantage in that way. He can pin his thought upon paper before it escapes him. The turn of a sentence will slip out of a quick thinker's mind before he can fix it in longhand. Well, sir, I've done all that is to be done in this direction, and I'm afraid we shall make nothing of the lodger in Dynevor Street." Arnold thanked him, and again offered to write a cheque. "No, no, sir. Keep your cheque-book in your pocket, if you please. I'm not a poor man, and I don't want to be paid for my failures," said Faunce. "But I've caused you to waste your time." "I've wasted it more to my liking than I should have done in the garden, and the plants and flowers are doing well, which they wouldn't have been if I had had a hand in their management. Wait till I get on to a better line, Mr. Wildover. It will be time enough to think of remuneration when I succeed." Arnold lost all hope of ultimate success, and began to waver in his resolve to keep aloof from the girl he loved. Why should he be too proud to be happy? She had sued to him for pardon, and had told him that she believed in him, had almost told him she loved him. He had to but seize the golden opportunity, and she would be his loving wife. Yes, but when the morning of love was spent, in the dull afternoon of life, if her heart grew colder, as women's hearts do sometimes grow, chilled by the bleak wind of years, what if old fears should revive, and she should begin to doubt and wonder, and he should see in her eyes that the mystery of Lisa's death was coming like a shadow between them? Would not that be hard to bear? And while he was longing to jump into the first prowling hansom that crept along the curb and drive to Hexton Gardens, he had to endure Wilmot Armstrong's expatiations upon the young lady to whom he was engaged, and finally had to consent to be taken to afternoon tea with the young lady's people. It was a long time before even friendship and gratitude combined could bring him to this point. The London season was waning, and the planes and sycamores on the embankment were shabby with the dust and grime of a London summer, when he put on a tall hat and carried a pair of light gloves to walk through the shabby streets between the Strand and Bloomsbury. "It's rather dreadful for Ida to live in Russell Square," said Wilmot apologetically, when they were halfway through Endell Street. "If Russell Square is anything like this, it must be dreadful." "Oh, but it ain't, not a bit. Don't you know Russell Square?" "I know nothing in this neighbourhood except Dynevor Street. That got itself imprinted pretty deep in my memory, you see. I remember the street, too, faintly. Lisa and I walked this way after we left the theatre. Yes, it was along here, a mild winter night, soft and grey. I remember what she was saying as we passed that building, and her face as she looked up at me in the moonlight. Do you know what that feeling is, Wilmot? The feeling of not having acted fair and square to someone who is dead, of having done something or left something undone? It gnaws like 10,000 rats. Well, don't ever give yourself that pain." "Dear old chap, I know you wanted to do the best you could for her." "No, no, I didn't, Will. I wanted to do the best I could for myself. I was sorry for her, and I was grateful to her for the love she bore me, but my love for her was dead." "What ought you to have done, then? Marry her without caring for her? Make a martyr of yourself for her to find it out afterwards and be miserable?" "God knows. She is gone, and the heart I wounded that night can be healed by no kindness of mine. Perhaps there is a world where she thinks of me and forgives me. Arnold, we are close to the square, and I want you to look your brightest." "Well, I won't be drearier than I can help. I'll sun myself in your Ida's beauty." "Oh, but she is not beautiful." "No, no, that's too big a word. She is only inexpressibly nice, and she has a perfect figure." His tone was apologetic to timidity. Arnold remembered how he had raved about his divinity in the summer nights, as they sat in the balcony smoking meditative pipes and watching the starshine on housetops and river. "Her father is a philanthropist," pursued Wilmot. "That is why they live in Russell Square."
"As how?"
"Well, the houses are large, you see, and rents much lower than in Mayfair. The rooms do for committee meetings and deputations and tea parties for the working classes, and that kind of thing. And that is all Mr. and Mrs. Borrowdale care about."
"Is Borrowdale a socialist?" Arnold asked eagerly.
"Socialist? No, no. A philanthropist."
"Isn't it pretty much the same thing?
They both affect a monstrous interest in the working man, and both would like to put a knife into their superiors."
"Nothing of that sort about the Borrowdales.
Here we are."
End of chapter 11. Chapter 12 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 12. 19th Century Crusaders. Mr. Borrowdale's house was one of the largest in Russell Square. The doorsteps were spotless. The windows were clean. But there were no flower boxes, no strivings after prettiness. The butler had a severe countenance. The hall was businesslike and might have belonged to an insurance office. The dark red Brussels carpet on the stone stairs had been worn threadbare by the tread of serious middle age. The spacious drawing-rooms were furnished in the early Victorian manner. Rosewood tables and chiffoniers, rosewood chairs with red silk cushions, red silk curtains, whereof the deep festoons and heavy fringes seemed carefully planned to exclude light and air. There was the little third room, which looked like a concession to modernity and youth, and which was indeed Ida Borrowdale's boudoir. And in this sanctuary Arnold was introduced to a tall, fair-haired girl with a long neck and a slim waist, and just pretty enough to appear a goddess to the man who loved her. "We are going to have tea here," said Ida, "before the meeting. There will be tea for the world in general afterwards."
"Meeting?" echoed Arnold. "What meeting?"
"Haven't you been told about it? Oh, Wilmot, how shocking of you to trap Mr. Wentworth into one of father's prosy meetings," shaking a reproving finger at her sweetheart. "They are all as good as gold," she went on, explaining the case to Arnold. "But they make speeches, and speeches are always prosy, aren't they, mother?" addressing herself to a languid lady in a pale gray tea gown, who crept quietly into the room at this juncture, and was installed in her easy chair and built round with small satin pillows, which, being of a downy and slippery nature, kept falling out of the chair with every movement of the languid lady, who was a professional invalid, and who acknowledged her daughter's introduction to Mr. Wentworth with the air of a sufferer for whom even that trifling exertion was a painful effort. Nobody ever remembered hearing Mrs. Borrowdale own to feeling even tolerably well, and no doctor had ever been able to discover the exact nature of Mrs. Borrowdale's malady. But there were those among her friends of long years who suspected that the lady had resorted to chronic ill health as the only practicable mode of escape from the weariness of drawing-room meetings and philanthropic labors. "Your father's speeches are always full of interest, upon whatever subject he speaks, my dear," Mrs. Borrowdale said with dignity. "It's all very well for you to admire his eloquence, Mummy dear. You aren't obliged to hear him," retorted Ida. "I know father speaks well, and to the point, but Lord Hilliard is just a shade prosy sometimes. I think even Lady Violet must feel that."
"I hope Lady Violet knows how to appreciate her father, who is a saint on earth."
"Oh, I know how much he has done, and that he spends almost all his income on the poor. But even a saint might be boring, you know, mother dearest."
"I take the keenest interest in my husband's noble efforts," said Mrs. Borrowdale, addressing herself to Arnold. "And it is one of my saddest deprivations that I dare not be present at these delightful meetings."
Gradually, while Ida poured out the tea, and her sweetheart handed cake and bread and butter
and made himself clumsily useful. The nature of the entertainment to which he had been beguiled was explained to Arnold. It was a drawing-room meeting, to be holden in the spacious front room between 5 and 6, the meeting of half a dozen or so of philanthropists, and as many of their friends as could be induced to come and listen to them, while they held forth upon the benighted condition of the working man in a certain overcrowded slum of Lisson Grove, and discussed measures for ameliorating the present state of things by the introduction of educational, sanitary, and recreative sweetness and light. Subscriptions to this good work would be strenuously entreated in the room, and a collection was to be made on the landing as the audience departed.
"It's a shocking trap for people who don't know what a drawing-room meeting means," Wilmot said apologetically.
"People who are not interested in their fellow creatures are hardly fit to live," said Ida, who had been brought up in an atmosphere of philanthropy.
"We shall have Mr. Greswold,
who is a delightful speaker," said Mrs. Borrowdale.
"But a little apt to repeat himself," objected Wilmot. "He is rather too studied for my taste."
"That's because you have no taste, Will," answered Ida, asserting the young lady's right to snub a sweetheart. "Mr. Greswold is simply perfect as a speaker."
"And most earnest and energetic as a man. He is Lord Hilliard's right hand," said her mother.
"And I hope Lord Hilliard will reward his devotion by letting Lady Violet marry him," said Ida.
"Good as Mr. Greswold is,
he would hardly be a suitable alliance for an earl's daughter," Mrs. Borrowdale objected with a touch of solemnity. Mr. Borrowdale had made his fortune in commerce, and Mrs. Borrowdale had never got over her reverence for the peerage and her consideration for peers and their belongings as a race apart. The butler removed the tea-table, and they all went to the large drawing-room, where half a dozen rows of cane chairs were arranged for an audience, and where Arnold was introduced to Lord Hilliard and Mr. Borrowdale, two large, comfortable-looking gentlemen with bald heads, white beards, and white waistcoats, who were very gracious and hoped he would be interested in the work in hand, to which end Mr. Borrowdale gave him a descriptive leaflet written by Lord Hilliard, in which the worse-than-Central-African state of life in Millicent Walk, Lisson Grove, was depicted in moving language. For the remedy of these evils, it was proposed to buy a whole block of tenements with a view to their reconstruction or improvement, and to convert one of them into a mission chapel and another into a hall of recreation and public laundry. The room began to fill while Arnold sat in the fourth row reading his leaflet. When he had finished it, his attention wandered to a young lady and gentleman who were standing in the recess of the window nearest him, talking earnestly. The man was of middle height, thin and wiry, and had lost all the freshness of youth. He was not bald, but his hair was thin, and he had the London pallor and the London look of late hours and too much brain work. A burner of the midnight oil, Arnold thought. A journalist, perhaps. His features were refined, the nose thin and aquiline, the nostrils pinched, the upper lip long and bloodless, the chin square and too large for perfect proportion. He had fine eyes of a dark hazel, full and large, and the eyelids and eyebrows were good and well defined. He was a man whom some people might call handsome, and whom nobody would call bad-looking. His clothes were of that universal and correct metropolitan fashion which invites no attention and can offend no one. The girl with whom he was talking was tall and distinguished-looking, a brunette with black hair brushed back from a broad, full brow with a severe simplicity which suits one face in 100. In an age of hidden foreheads, Lady Violet could afford to leave her brow unshaded. The perfect arch of the strongly marked eyebrows gave character to the face. The small, straight nose and firm mouth suggested hauteur, and it was only Lady Violet's rare smile which gave assurance of womanly gentleness and amiability. She was graver than her age and sex warranted, and it seemed to those who knew her best
as if her youth had been overshadowed by the miseries of all those people, from palsied age to starved and neglected infancy, for whom Lord Hilliard had laboured ever since she was born. To be born in the purple, to have a hereditary right to live in the best society aristocratic England can afford, had meant nothing to Violet. Of fashionable amusements she knew only the names. A long rural ride with her father in the dewy morning, croquet or tennis with the vicar's daughters, or the humdrum house party of cousins and old friends, or a walk with the Hanoverian governess who had been with her since her mother's death, and from whose sole tuition she had learnt all she knew of the sister art. These were her recreations. Other girls of her rank in London had Herr Wolf to teach them the fiddle, or were luxuriating in pastels under Mrs. Jopling. Other girls of her rank in the country were following the hounds for a 7 hours' day, wringing the backs of a couple of high-bred hunters. Other girls had their pals, and their tame cats, in their particular circles, and were sylphs, or seraphs, or anything ridiculous they liked to call themselves, and revelled in the fantastic and the expensive. But Lord Hilliard's daughter had been brought up to care for none of these things. She saw them only from afar off, and wondered at them, wondered to see young faces brilliant with painted bloom, and girls of her own age wearing frocks and hats, the cost of which would have put new roofs on their father's cottages, or provided good drainage and pure water in villages that steamed and stank under the August sun. Violet suffered from no sense of loss or deprivation. There had been no parsimony in her father's system. A liberal economy, rather, in which nothing was stinted and nothing wasted. Her governess's salary was on the highest scale. Her French maid was the best and cleverest and most conscientious young person whom careful inquiry among Protestant pastors in Paris could produce. Everything Lady Violet had or wore was of the best that money could buy, and the houses in which she lived, the fine old Stuart Manor house near Beverley, and the spacious house in Hyde Park Gardens, were so bright and gracious in every detail as to dispel the idea that gloom or ugliness had any place in Lord Hilliard's philosophy of life. "Let us do all we can to make other people's lives happy, and then we can enjoy our own," he said. And after she had overcome the great sorrow of her mother's death, which happened before she was 11 years old, Lady Violet had enjoyed every hour of her life. She adored her father with a worshipping love. There was no saint in the calendar whom she would have counted his superior. "He will live in men's memories as a saint when we are all dead and forgotten," she said to Oliver Greswold one day, when he had been first praising her father, and then complaining of the opposition some of his wisest efforts had to encounter. Greswold was socially on a much lower plane, but had been admitted to friendly and even familiar relations upon the broad claims of philanthropy. He had gradually dropped, or slid, into the position of his lordship's unpaid private secretary, and was entrusted with matters more delicate than the daily work of the salaried clerk, whose pen was going steadily all day upon the business of charity. Greswold was a radical, a philanthropist, and a deep thinker, intense in all he did and thought. As a radical, he went far beyond Lord Hilliard, yet while eager to level downwards, he had no enthusiastic appreciation of the upward tendencies, the possibilities of improvement in the masses whose cause he served. He was a pessimist in politics, and though he kept his opinions upon religion scrupulously to himself, Lord Hilliard feared that he was an unbeliever, and that in his creed the narrow limits of this little life bounded the possibilities of human improvement. It was always of the race he spoke, seldom of individual men. The chairs were filling while Arnold sat idly watching these two, interested in both faces, suspecting that they were something more than everyday friends. He was still looking at them when a hand in a pale gray glove touched him lightly on the sleeve, stretched from the row behind him, and a clear young voice murmured his name. He turned quickly and discovered Mary Freeland sitting just behind him, charmingly dressed in half-mourning and looking her prettiest.
"How odd that you should be here this afternoon," she said, and then looking at a portly lady in black satin who sat near her, "Mr. Wentworth, Mrs. Tressilian Smith."
Mrs. Smith smiled and held out an affable hand. "I am so glad to meet you at last, Mr. Wentworth," she said graciously. "I have met all your people when I have been staying with my sister. Mrs. Wentworth is a charming person. I only hope you are like her. Do you know Lord Hilliard?"
"Only by his public work. I am here as a guest of Mrs. Borrowdale's. Do you know the Borrowdale's?"
"You never need ask that question," said Mary. "Mrs. Tressilian Smith knows everybody. She gives the most delightful parties in London."
"I hope you will come to some of my parties, even if you have to scold Miss Freeland for overpraising them."
"I should be delighted, only I am too much of a South African savage to trust myself at a fashionable party. I should be doing something dreadful, and you would be sorry you had asked me."
"You are a nasty, disagreeable thing," said Mary in a shrewish whisper.
"It would take a long residence in South Africa to spoil a son of Mrs. Wentworth's," said Mrs. Smith.
And then a preliminary cough from Lord Hilliard, who was now in his place as chairman, imposed silence. Arnold, who had not come to hear the sorrows of a Marylebone slum, felt utterly happy in the near neighbourhood of Mary Freeland. How her eyes had sparkled with pleasure at meeting him! How clear she made it to the meanest comprehension that he had but to ask and claim her! Paradise, the sweet companionship, the untempestuous bliss of united lives, the calm home haven for which every good man longs, could be his for the asking. "But then some day she might round upon me and say she always knew I was a murderer," he told himself gloomily. "I should be a weak fool were I to surrender myself to that easy happiness before I have the stain off my name. I should deserve the worst that could happen to me in the future." He looked about the room, or rather with a wise instinct, looked into the corners of the room for Wilmot and his sweetheart, and presently descried them screwed into two chairs near the door, whispering to each other and demonstratively indifferent to the proceedings. Lord Hilliard briefly stated the class of wretchedness that he and others were anxious to ameliorate. A medical man followed, speaking at some length upon the health question, and then a lady in nurse's uniform spoke about nursing, and after her came a speaker who took up the discourse upon the side of morality, and each had specifics for creating a clean and sinless little Eden out of an unsanitary Tophet. If the money were found for nurse and dispensary, mission room and night school, drain pipes and Bibles, cisterns and infant nursery. A buzz and whisper ran round the room as the man who had been talking to Lady Violet came to the space in front of Lord Hilliard's table and prepared to address the audience. He received more attention even before he opened his lips than had been evoked by the highest oratorical flights of the other speakers. This fact alone would have aroused Arnold's attention, had he not been already interested in the appearance of the man. "I am so glad Mr. Greswold is going to speak," said Mrs. Tressilian Smith to her neighbour. "He is a magnificent speaker."
"Too artificial for my taste," replied the gentleman she had addressed, "and he repeats himself odiously. I have heard the same burst of eloquence, the same peroration, half a dozen times."
This Greswold was an accomplished public speaker, a man who had made oratory a fine art. The low, quiet voice in which he began penetrated to the furthest corner of the room. Without effort, in the easiest way, he took the audience into his confidence, and told in the plainest language of plain facts which the previous speakers had understated or ignored. And then, passing from that unadorned statement of cruel sufferings and cruel wrongs, he went on, with a change of voice and manner that thrilled his audience, to the socialist view of those wrongs, the socialist scathing denunciation of the rich and happy who know not or will not know the sin and sufferings of the helots that take all the ugliness of life upon their shoulders in exchange for a crust of bread watered with tears. His views might be exaggerated, romantic, unsound, but his words held his hearers, and among the audience, mostly women, few heard him dry-eyed. There was a thrill in his deep voice which thrilled their nerves, like the silvery boyish treble in a cathedral choir. His words were burning words. Mary Freeland felt like giving up half her income, and even Mrs. Tressilian Smith, who had intended to put half a crown in the collecting bag, resolved on the sacrifice of a sovereign. Arnold listened, and owned to himself that speech like this was a great gift and a great power. "If I were a good speaker, I would go into Parliament tomorrow," he thought, and he wondered that this man had not found his way into the House before now. Suddenly a phrase, a word, struck on his ear as if a gun had been fired close beside him. He leant forward, grasping the top rail of the chair in front of him with both hands, to the derangement of some fluffy decoration upon the neck of the lady seated there, who turned and rebuked his bad manners with a scowl. He saw not the look. His eyes were fixed upon the speaker. His ears were absorbing the speaker's words. Word for word, sentence for sentence, he heard the words and phrases copied from the shorthand notes found in the Dynevor Street lodging-house. Every syllable was engraved upon his memory. He had no need to refer to the paper in his letter-case, against which his agitated heart was thumping. This was the lodger of Dynevor Street, the man who had lived his silent, solitary life in a room within the view of Lisa Rayner's dwelling, and who had disappeared from Dynevor Street within 24 hours after her death. This was the man. He wore no spectacles today, and from the easy way in which he glanced at his notes during the statistical part of his address, he was evidently not short-sighted. The clear, strong outlook of the keen gray eyes was not that of a man who now suffered, or had lately suffered, from any defect of vision. The blue spectacles worn in Dynevor Street were assumed with a motive. The man was in hiding there for some reason or other. The man was there under an assumed name. Arnold, in his wild eagerness, could imagine, could believe in, only one reason. The man was there as an intending murderer, lurking, hiding, waiting, and watching for the fatal opportunity. Such things have been in Italy often enough to be commonplace. The victim has walked the streets of Rome or Florence, the narrow alleys of Venice, the arcades of Bologna, careless, unknowing, the assassin stalking near, the hired dagger ready to leap from his breast. But here, what motive for stealthy murder? What motive, unless that which Faunce had suggested, a life to be suppressed? But the reason for suppressing that obscure life? What could there be in the relations of this man and Lisa Rayner to make her existence a terror or a trouble to him? Was he a lover of the past? A lover of whose existence Lisa, in her spontaneous confession, had given no hint? Did he represent an episode in her life which she, so seemingly candid, had carefully concealed? Some link there must have been between them, if he were indeed the murderer, since his social status precluded the idea of a murder to assist a theft. The audience rose in a storm of kid-gloved applause and a murmured chorus of approval, while Arnold sat bewildered. Greswold had been chosen to wind up the meeting, to make the final strenuous appeal to the hearts and the purses of the audience. He was often so chosen, for the little band of good men with whom he worked fully recognized his power to play upon human heartstrings. People were moving to the door. Gold and silver were dropping into the silken bags which Lady Violet and Ida Borrowdale held, standing on each side of the lofty Georgian doorway, through which Fat Joe Sedley may have passed in his heyday of turtle and nankin. The room was half empty before Arnold had pulled himself together and was conscious of his surroundings and of Mary Freeland's looking back at him as she followed her portly chaperone. She lingered long enough to allow of his joining her before she reached the door.
"There is tea downstairs," she said to him. "Would it bore you very much to get some for Mrs. Tressilian Smith and me? There is sure to be a crush."
"I shall be enchanted."
"How sweet of you!
Mr. Greswold's speech gave me cold water down my back. I am going to subscribe at least 50 guineas. I ought to give them a year's income."
"And go without frocks and food for a year?"
"Why shouldn't I do my share of starving? It would be better than eating expensive soles in Lent and calling it religion to go without meat and poultry. Better at any rate than to be one of those who don't know and won't know how their fellow creatures suffer. Wasn't Mr. Greswold splendid? He thrills one with such plain speech, such commonplace words, and then he spreads his wings like Ruskin or Carlyle."
"You prodigiously admire this Mr. Greswold."
"As a speaker," she answered quickly.
"Have you ever met him?"
"Oh, very often. He comes to Hexton Garden sometimes, but I have seldom talked to him. He is always in such request."
"Why?"
"Oh, because he is really distinguished, I suppose. He speaks and he writes for the Radical papers, and he is awfully benevolent and philanthropic."
"And religious, no doubt. A man of exemplary piety."
"No, that is the saddest part of it. Though he is so good and unselfish and self-sacrificing, he is not a believer. It is so sad for Lady Violet."
"Why?"
"Oh, she is so devoted to him, and I dare say she would be allowed to marry him, though he is of very inferior birth, if he were not a free thinker."
They were in the crowded tea-room by this time, where Arnold had pioneered them into a comfortable corner, and where Wilmot and his Ida presently joined them. End of chapter 12. Chapter 13 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 13. Mr. Faunce's report continued. The identity of the speckled lodger in Dynevor Street with Oliver Greswold, a writer and speaker upon socialistic and philanthropic subjects of some repute in his own particular circle, having been indicated by a fluke, it became my business to discover his connection, if any, with the murdered woman on the other side of the street. The fact that his residence in an obscure Bloomsbury lodging-house was a secret and stealthy business was proved by the alias and the dark spectacles. I took occasion to see the gentleman several times after Mr. Wildover's discovery, and I never saw him wearing spectacles, or even using an eyeglass, nor could I hear from anybody that he had ever used one or the other. His grandfather's old manservant, with whom I became very friendly in my casual way, told me that Mr. Oliver had the eye of an auk. My first business was to find out all I could about Greswold's surroundings and antecedents before approaching the problem of his association with the murdered woman. To discover the link between the two, I must first know what the man was and what kind of life he had led. It was easy to know his life and surroundings as the world knew them, since his active share in the good Lord Hilliard's work had made him a public character. He was known to have very small means in the present, but considerable expectations from his grandfather, a man of advanced age, who led a secluded life in a dreary-looking house on Clapham Common, one of the largest houses in that neighborhood,
and with grounds covering 5 or 6 acres, now of considerable value. There can be no interest to anybody in the details of my work. I shall therefore sum them up in a single word. Patience. Patience enabled me to overcome the dogged reserve of the curmudgeon who had been the head of the elder Greswold's house for nearly 40 years, and whose memory, unobscured by book learning, was a storehouse of facts relating to the Greswold family. Patience, and a trifling outlay upon glasses of brandy and water at the Flower Pot Tavern in the Clapham Road, placed me upon a friendly and confidential footing with Benjamin Lutgater, butler, valet, and factotum to Mr. Andrew Greswold of the Belvedere Clapham, family solicitor and reputed millionaire. In less than a month from the day when I first dropped into the tavern parlor, where the old man-servant spent his evening leisure, having heard all about his habits from a loquacious grocer's boy, Ludgater and I were familiar friends. He had accepted my own account of myself as a retired tradesman resident at Putney, and strolling over to Clapham 2 or 3 times a week in the long evenings for the sake of the walk. And by slow degrees, beginning with reluctant and churlish assent to my remarks about the weather or the contents of the evening paper, he had unbent so far as to spend the greater part of the evening prosing at my ear and to entertain me with interminable stories of the governor and the family. From him I heard that old Greswold had begun life in a small way as a solicitor in Hatton Garden, but by the help of certain business associations with the turf had made himself a law and power in all turf questions, and had invested his early savings in the betting ring to such advantage as to enable him to exchange Hatton Garden for Mayfair within the first decade of his professional career. In Mayfair he had lived over his offices, and it had been Ludgater's privilege to supervise such little dinners as can only be given by the happy few who live within a stone's throw of Berkeley Square. To such dinners, never less than the gracers or more than the musers, as Master used to tell his friends, came some of the biggest toffs in London, toffs who looked up to Mr. Greswold as to a father, whose stamped paper filled Mr. Greswold's most sacred dispatch boxes, upon whose drags Mr. Greswold was driven to Epsom, and in whose houses at Sunningdale or Virginia Water he stayed during the Ascot week. It was not till Mr. Greswold was past 50 and beginning to talk of retiring from business, much to the distress of the toffs, that he went to live at Clapham. He might never have gone there had the property not fallen into him as part of a bad debt, after the suicide of a young racing man, born of city people, who had been imprudent enough to push his way into the toff world, and whose plebeian spirit had failed him in a financial crux out of which a toff would have emerged smiling. This low-born tradesman's son must needs cut his throat rather than face cross-examination in the bankruptcy court. Mr. Greswold married soon after taking possession of the Clapham property, and here he lived for some years in great splendor, Ludgater having a footman and page under him. Here also Mr. Greswold took upon himself a reputation for shining piety. Family prayers morning and evening, church morning and evening on Sundays, liberal subscriptions to charities, liberal treatment of servants. He had married a very handsome woman, 20 years his junior, of whose connections and antecedents even his confidential servant Ludgater had discovered nothing. She might have dropped from the clouds from all I knew about her, until they took to quarrelling in my hearing, and then he threw things in her face that showed pretty plain the class she come from, Ludgater told me. The pair were badly matched and miserable together, but whatever her past conduct, the wife behaved like an honest woman in her husband's house. She bore him 2 children, a boy and a girl. The father adored the girl and detested the boy. The mother idolized the boy and resented her husband's preference for the girl.
This was the beginning of domestic warfare. Their first quarrels were about the children. The wife fell into a decline and died in the south of France before the children grew up, and after her death the daughter became practically her own mistress, indulged in every whim, quarrelling with one governess after another, and making slaves of the women servants. The boy did well at school, and at the university was called to the bar, married the daughter of a distinguished Queen's Counsel, for whom he had devilled, and was beginning to be known as a rising junior, when the consumptive trait showed itself, and he followed his mother to her grave in a foreign cemetery. He left a son of 7 years old, and a widow who was much too pretty to remain long widowed. There had been no marriage settlement, and the orphan was left wholly unprovided for, so the grandfather took charge of him and tolerated him. It had never been more than toleration, Ludgater told me. However well his grandson did at school, whatever honors he won at Cambridge, the old man still looked coldly upon him, and always kept him short of money. Before the grandson came into the house, the daughter had gone out of it forever. She had vanished one summer night after a violent quarrel with her father, a quarrel that had been more desperate than the worst that Ludgater could remember between husband and wife. The girl had gone out of her father's house, angry and defiant, to join her lot with a man whom her father denounced as a swindler, one of Greswold's Mayfair visitors, a man of good birth, a sprig of nobility, Ludgater called him, but of the worst possible character. Her father swore never to see her again, and never had pronounced her name in Ludgater's hearing since that night. "You can chuck all the rubbish out of the south bedroom and boudoir, and lock the doors of both rooms," he told Ludgater. The old servant opined that the word rubbish included all Miss Greswold's personal belongings, so he touched nothing, believing that her father would relent in course of time. He shut the shutters of all the windows and locked the two doors, and gave the keys to his master, who asked for them, and the rooms had never been opened within his knowledge since he closed them. "You can see those windows with the old-fashioned Venetian shutters from the road," Ludgater said, "and you may think how thick the dust must lie, and how heavy the cobwebs must hang upon everything after over 30 years. Within a month of Miss Greswold's disappearance, all the splendours of the Belvedere, Clapham, had vanished as completely as the fugitive daughter herself. Ludgater was now the only manservant in the great empty house, and the whole indoor establishment was reduced to himself and two women. All the large reception rooms were closed, the furniture covered with brown holland, the Axminster carpets rolled up, and opposing, as it were, an earthwork against the intruder who ventured to pry into those desolate apartments. Of the seven gardeners who had made the Belvedere flower beds and hothouses the admiration of Clapham, only one was left to mow the grass and roll the gravel walks on which the gloomy owner paced to and fro for hours on end, summer and winter, fair weather or foul. Of all the flowers that had bloomed there, only the hardiest perennials remained to blossom and fade unheeded. It was at this time that Greswold's piety assumed a gloomier cast. He now took to religion as some men take to drink. He attached himself to a low church preacher of the most rigid Calvinistic views, and expected all his household to attend the Sunday services in a hot, ugly church, and to listen to prayers and scripture readings morning and night. "How does his grandson stand that kind of thing?" I ask. "He has to stand it, as long as master lives, if he don't want to be cut off with an angry shilling. Everybody, except the master, knows that Mr. Oliver don't believe in nothing but earthworms and climbing plants and such like. I've seen the books on the table by his bed. But he has to go to church, and to eat cold beef and salad on Sundays, or he'd soon get the key of the street, instead of the latch-key that has never been allowed him." Nothing has ever been heard of the vanished daughter. If the father knew her fate, whether she was living or dead, he kept his own counsel. None of her belongings, clothes, trinkets, girlish possessions, had ever been taken out of the house. They were there after 30 years, mouldering in the sealed rooms. Ludgater had once heard his master, in a moment of irritation, remind his grandson that he had other heirs, those who might be dearer to him than the offspring of that starched prig, his son. This speech had impressed the old servant, and he inclines to think that the daughter is still living, and that her father may have forgiven her, or that she has left offspring whom he knows and protects. My progress up to this point was satisfactory, but I found it difficult to get any further, as Ludgater had forgotten the name of the sprig of nobility, as well as the noble tree on which he grew. That threat of the old man's was an indication that had to be followed, for here was at once the suggestion of motive, could I trace the offspring of the rebellious daughter in the murdered Lisa Rayner. Yet it would be hard to believe that old Greswold could boast of heirs near and dear, and leave one of them to sink so low as that unhappy young woman had fallen, long before her tragical death. If he knew of their existence, he would surely have cared for them. If he had no knowledge of them, he would hardly have uttered such a threat. I tried to realize the position of Oliver Greswold, brought up in the house of a wealthy grandfather, ostensibly his sole heir, but threatened with the existence of a hidden rival or rivals. Suppose there were one rival only, and the man knew who and what she was, her fallen and friendless condition. Suppose he knew that a will were made in her favor, or were likely to be made in her favor. There was motive enough in the mind of a villain for putting her out of the world. Could I believe a young man of Oliver Griswold's presumed character, a man of blameless life, whose voice was never raised except in a good cause, whose eloquence could draw tears, who had labored early and late for the help and improvement of his fellow men? Could I believe that under the spotless skin of this philanthropist there beat the heart of a murderer? Well, yes. After 25 years' experience of human nature's dark side, I can believe in anybody's wickedness. I set no limit on myself there. My only difficulty is to believe in human goodness. But somehow I like Wildover, and I like working for him. My business is now to learn all Wildover can tell me about the unhappy girl's antecedents. He has been very reticent on this point, and to follow up any clue he can give me till I discover her history and parentage. The odds are that after taking infinite trouble, I shall find her totally unconnected with the Greswold family, and so find myself no nearer the discovery of any link between Oliver Greswold and the murder in Dynevor Street. The mere fact of his being a resident in that street under a false name may have no bearing on the murder. There are many motives for hiding. Debt, politics, love. Yet with a man of Greswold's respectability, it is not easy to suppose any such motive. Nor was there any hint of a petticoat at the lodging-house. And there is the curious fact that the man who bought a pistol in Holborn is described as of middle height, slim, studious-looking, and wearing smoke-colored spectacles. The work will be slow and may be unsuccessful, but it suits me better than picking caterpillars off the rose bushes or watering the geraniums in the long summer evenings. End of chapter 13. Chapter 14 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 14. The Boyhood of Oliver Greswold. After the drawing-room meeting in Russell Square, Arnold became on very friendly terms with Wilmot's Ida, and was induced to join the lovers in visits to picture galleries and other places of public entertainment.
to which the young lady went in custody of a serious aunt, whose piety was tempered by an insatiable thirst for mundane pleasures, and who talked in the same breath of her favourite parsons and her favourite actors. This lady had battened upon her elder sister's bad health, and enjoyed all the privileges of a chaperone, which included every picture gallery in London, a good many of the best morning concerts, light luncheons at the nicest West End confectioners or cafes, and stalls at the Lyceum and Haymarket for every new play, the expense of which entertainments Wilmot cheerfully defrayed for the delight of being with his Ida. As he grew more intimate with the young lady, Arnold was able to question her freely about Oliver Greswold, and from her he learnt all that the Borrowdales knew of Lord Hilliard's unpaid secretary. He had been allied with his lordship for 6 or 7 years, Ida told Arnold, and his attachment to Lady Violet was an open secret to all the world, except the dear old mole, Lord Hilliard, who could never see anything outside St. Giles or Whitechapel. Did Ida think that he would consent to his daughter's marriage with Griswold? Ida thought he would sacrifice all caste prejudice if Mr. Griswold were to come into a fortune and were able to help the great cause with money as well as with his brains. Mr. Griswold had great expectations from a miserly grandfather who lived in a dismal old house on Clapham Common, surrounded by gardens and paddocks that were supposed to be worth a fortune as building land. "He keeps that poor young man dreadfully short of money, and wouldn't even let him go to the bar because it would cost something. Father says he has just the clothes he wears and his board and lodging at Clapham, so it is impossible for him to put himself forward as a suitor for Lady Violet until his grandfather dies. However, as the old wretch is nearly 90, it's to be hoped he will make up his mind to do that before long." "But is Griswold sure of being his grandfather's heir?" "Oh, no doubt. Such an old wretch might leave everything to a hospital. But there are no other relations, and Oliver Griswold has been brought up in his grandfather's house, so that ought to mean being his heir." "And you think Lady Violet would marry him if he asked her?" "Like a bird," replied Ida, who had adopted some of her Wilmot's phrases, and prided herself upon them, as she prided herself upon writing like him, though his penmanship was execrable. Lady Violet accompanied Ida on one of their picture mornings, and Arnold, who had the honour of escorting her through the galleries, found it very easy to lead her to talk about Oliver Griswold. From her he heard how hard the young man's lot had been, and how the fire of unsatisfied ambitions was consuming his youth. "He ought to be in the house," she said. "He could help every good cause if he were there, for he was a born leader of men. William Pitt was a power at his age. He would be in the house if my father were rich enough to help him. It is hard to see men who are so inferior to him making great names, while he is known only to a few. You heard him speak. You know what kind of speaker he is." "I thought him a very fine speaker, but eloquence is not everything in the House of Commons, and some distinguished orators have failed there. Griswold may not have the genius of debate." "You do not know how clever he is, or you would not say that. My father and I have known him for a good many years, and we know what there is in him, and that he only requires a proper platform. It is so hard that want of money should stop the way, but every door is barred with gold, and opens but to golden keys," concluded Lady Violet with a sigh. Her face, which revealed every feeling, glowed with enthusiasm as she talked of the man she loved. She told Arnold how nobly he had assisted every scheme of her father's, how indefatigable, how clever and far-seeing he had been. Looking at pictures was a secondary pleasure compared with talking of Oliver Griswold to a sympathetic listener, and to Violet's mind, Wentworth's eager interest could spring only from genuine admiration for the man she loved. He asked her if Griswold always lived at Clapham, in the dreary house with the miserly grandfather. "Always,
At least I only remember one occasion where he lived anywhere else, and that was last winter, when he had lodgings in some street near the British Museum. He is writing a book about trade unionism and workmen's societies of all kinds, and he wanted to be near the museum library. He had to work there every day. She knew all about it then. He had made no secret of his residence in Bloomsbury. This shook Arnold's conviction and dampened his ardor. His spirit sank at the idea that he had lighted on a mare's nest. Yet, if there were no evil intent, why did Greswold disfigure himself with spectacles and assume an alias? "Do you remember the name of the street where he lodged?" he asked. And then, as if in answer to her surprised look, I am thinking of reading up a little mineralogy in case I ever go back to the gold fields, and I should like to know of decent lodgings near the museum. I don't remember the address. I doubt if I ever heard it. He was with my father every day, and we had no occasion to write to him. But I'll ask him if you like. Please don't. He would think me a troublesome fool. Here comes Miss Borrowdale. She will say I am hindering you from looking at the pictures. I am always glad to talk to anyone who is interested in my father's work, she said. Arnold called at Faunce's suburban villa that evening and related his conversation with Lady Violet, but Faunce received the communication quite coolly. The man would have to account for his absence from Clapham, he said, and if he is the criminal we want, he would be wise enough to know that the nearer he kept to the actual truth, the less risk he would run of detection. There was nothing extraordinary in his wanting to live close to his work, but there's something extraordinary in his hiding his eyes and changing his name. Lady Violet was told the one fact, which seemed natural enough. Had he pretended to be on the other side of the Channel, or 100 miles away from London, he would have found it difficult to give a good reason for his absence, and might have been met in the street any hour in the day. But even as it was, how if he had been met disguised? Spectacles don't necessarily mean disguise. He would have accounted for them by affecting something amiss with his eyes. No, your Lady Violet has not made any change in my ideas. And now I have something to tell you. Arnold was all eagerness, and being enjoined to listen quietly and make no comments, this was the story he heard. Remembering the murdered woman's custom of wandering about the lonely squares and the Primrose Hill district after midnight, as described by her landlady and her fellow lodger, it had occurred to Faunce that she could hardly have escaped the observation of the constables on duty in those districts, if they were worth sixpence a night as observers of human nature. Alone or in company, she must have been a noticeable figure in the small hours. Proceeding upon this hypothesis, Faunce had interrogated the men in the locality, and had finally met with an intelligent Irish sergeant, whose beat lay between Primrose Hill and the Gloucester Road, and who had frequently remarked the lonely woman walking towards the hill after midnight, when the streets and roads were almost empty of human life, or walking towards London at a still late hour. He had seen her in the middle of the summer, walking eastward with the light upon her poor, pinched face. She always looked pretty much the same, the sergeant said, pale and melancholy, decently clad, quiet and respectable. He had never spoken to her, for he was sure that she had seen better days, and that it would vex her to know that she was noticed or watched. He had never seen her walking with anybody. She was always alone, and her eyes had a faraway look, as if she were always thinking the same kind of thoughts. One night, in the previous November, he had observed, to his surprise, that she was being followed, stealthily and at a distance, and he kept his eyes upon the follower as long as he could do so without leaving his section. The person following was a youngish man, slim, a little over the middle height, looking like a Londoner, wearing a loose brown overcoat and a brown felt hat. He was puzzled by this fact, as there was nothing attractive about the young woman's appearance or manner, and while the man was obviously watching her,
he made no attempt to stop her or to enter into conversation with her. He followed for the most part on the opposite side of the road, and far enough in her rear to prevent his footsteps being heard by her. The sergeant saw this man shadowing the woman three or four times in the course of as many weeks, in dull, foggy weather, and on fine, bright nights. But though it was obvious to him that the man's purpose was to watch and to follow this one lonely figure, the thing was so done that he felt shy of questioning the man. There was nothing that indicated any sinister purpose up to the night of the 20th of December, when something serious happened. The night was dry, but rough. There was a waning moon, which showed occasionally in a sky full of storm clouds. There was a southwest wind, and the night was particularly mild for the season. There had been showers early in the evening, and the earth and the trees about Gloucester Gate and Gloucester Road had a cool freshness which the sergeant enjoyed. He was hardly surprised to meet the lonely woman walking across the open ground at the top of Park Street, just as the York and Albany was closing. She walked at her usual brisk pace, and she went the way he was going to the hill. The moon was hidden now, and had been hidden for the last half hour. He could not see her, though he believed she was in front of him. Presently, nearer to him than he thought, he heard her light, quick footsteps, still in front, and, at the same minute, became aware of other footsteps, almost as light as hers, a little way behind him. He stopped and stood aside, hidden by a group of trees. The following footsteps passed him and went on. He waited, and by and by the woman passed, retracing her steps, the man following, always at the same distance. He heard his breathing as he passed, hurried, harder, and more agitated than it need have been, the sergeant thought, considering the easy pace at which he was walking. The woman crossed the road at the foot of the hill, and entered a long suburban street, one of those eminently respectable streets from which every token of human life vanishes soon after 11 o'clock. The man crossed the road as the woman had crossed, less than a minute after her. He was keeping closer to her than usual tonight. The man entered the street she had entered, but kept on the opposite side of the way, as usual, and the sergeant followed, keeping to the muddy roadway, so that the tramp of his regulation boots should not be heard by the people he was following, silent boots having not yet been adopted by the service. The sky was clearing, and the moon had looked out from among the clouds several times within the last hour. She leapt suddenly from behind a cloud bank as the sergeant entered the empty, silent street, and he saw that the position of the people he was following had changed. They were still upon opposite sides of the way, but the man was now considerably ahead of the woman. He drew aside as she approached, and stood in the shadow of a stuccoed porch. The street was a monotonous avenue of bay windows and pillared porches, the latter raised from the pavement only by a single shallow step. The man came out of the porch as the woman approached, and the sergeant saw him take deliberate aim at her with a pistol. He was just near enough to see the flash of steel in the moonlight.
"Holloa!" shouted the sergeant, and ran as fast as his boots would let him.
That shout may have saved a life, or only postponed murder. There was a cross street a few doors from the spot where the man had stood to take aim, and he was away around the corner before the sergeant came up with the woman, who had stopped at his shout, and had seen the man running away, but may have been unaware of the danger she had escaped. "Do you know that man?" gasped the sergeant, without stopping.
"No."
The sergeant, still without stopping, called to her to wait for him. He would be back in a few minutes. The side street was as long as the main avenue, and there were numerous turnings in it, some leading to Camden Town, others towards Regent's Park. He was in an endless labyrinth of middle-class gentility, stuccoed porches, bay windows, larger or smaller, more or less ornate. He gave up the chase after about 20 minutes, during which he had enlisted the service of a constable on his beat. Then he went back to the street where he had left the woman, fully expecting to find her waiting for him.
Surely a woman's curiosity, even had she no stronger motive, would induce her to wait and hear the end of so strange an adventure. She was gone. The sergeant paraded the neighboring streets for the rest of his time, but could not meet with her, and he never saw her again. Her nocturnal perambulations in that particular district were never repeated, or the sergeant must have met her. Whether he reported the occurrence on his sheet or not was a question which Faunce had not cared to push too closely. Poor soul! She had not long to wander alone under the stars after the 20th of December, said Arnold, with that dull aching pain which he felt whenever his thoughts reverted to the woman who had loved him. You take it for granted, then, that this wanderer was Lisa Rayner.
Have you any doubt of it?
Not much. If the lodger in Dynevor Street was there for the purpose of murder, it is highly improbable that his audacious entrance at number 13 on Christmas Eve was a first attempt. He would have tried a less hazardous method first, and to shoot his victim in a deserted street was certainly a much safer plan. I have no doubt he had made other attempts before the one the sergeant saw, and it was after several failures, for, you see, a London street is seldom as deserted as it looks, that he grew desperate, and watched for the first opportunity of getting into the house. He was watching you and Mrs. Rayner from the other side of the street, most likely, while you were walking up and down, and he may have crossed the street and slipped in at the half-open door while you and she were absorbed in that last farewell. Yes, that might have been. She was crying, and I took a handkerchief from my breast pocket and lifted her veil while I dried her tears. My back was towards the doorstep. Anyone might have gone in at that moment. I watched her as she went in 2 minutes afterwards, and heard the door shut firmly behind her. The murderer must have been hiding in the dark passage. I noticed that there was no gas, and wondered whether there were candle and matches ready for her in the hall, or whether she would have to grope her way upstairs in the dark. I was so sorry for her that it was only natural I should think of these details. Her hard life seemed ever so much more pitiable now I was prosperous, and I feared she was not going to let me help her to an easier life. Well, your sergeant's story is conclusive, a grand piece of circumstantial evidence. Not worth tuppence at the Old Bailey, convincing for you and me, perhaps, but useless for a jury.
Useless? Such evidence as that?
An indication only, not evidence as against Greswold. You may prove him to be the man who lodged with the Durfins and called himself Longman. A suspicious circumstance, no more. You have to find out whether he, Greswold, had any motive for getting rid of Lisa Rayner. Prove that much. Prove a reason for his wanting her dead and out of the way. Prove even by the evidence of the gunsmith that Greswold bought the pistol. You have still only a weak case against him. A few odd links in a chain, but not an unbroken chain, such as a judge and jury would require before they could believe that a man of Oliver Greswold's eminent virtues, leading a clean life, a good means, popular and respected, could be a cold-blooded murderer. What more is there to be done? Much, if you want to succeed. But I tell you again that if this man is the murderer, I don't believe you will ever see justice done, even though you and I may know that he deserves hanging. A moral certainty is one thing, a case for a jury is another. However, my business now, if I am to go on working for you, is to find out Lisa Rayner's early history, and to do this I must go to Vienna and try back from the point where her life began, when she was tempted away by her seducer. Not a very easy task when you consider that she came to England nearly 10 years ago, and that you can give me positively no clue to her name or whereabouts in Vienna. The only scrap of knowledge I have to begin with is the name in the little Lutheran testament, Lotchen Noack, Lisa von Lotchen Noack. My first step will be to advertise for Lotchen Noack in the Viennese papers. I don't know much of the German language, but I know that an educated German always writes their ridiculous character with a delicate regularity which makes penmanship a fine art. Now, Lottchen's autograph is an abominable scrawl, so I take it she belongs to the lower classes, the more likely to be easily found. No, Mr. Wildover, in cities the lower classes are the nomadic classes. Having been honored with Mrs. Tressilian Smith's card for three Thursday evenings, Arnold was not slow to seize the opportunity. Two influences drew him to the house in Hexton Gardens. First, the desire to see Mary Freeland, which was irresistible, though he had made up his mind to avoid her, and secondly, his ardent wish to meet Oliver Greswold, and to go down a little deeper into the nature of the man whom he had only seen in his public aspect. Face to face, and eye to eye, character might reveal itself in spite of the severest training in hypocrisy. Mary welcomed him with her sweetest smile, and to be with Mary was to be in paradise, even though it meant sitting in a corner of a hot room, made mute by air somebody's fiddle-scraping, for which he cared not a jot, but about which Mary was enthusiastic and even ferocious. "Hold your tongue, you goth," she whispered. "If you cannot listen to Chopin's nocturne in A-flat, you have no more ear than an African savage." "I should be sorry to have as much." He came on the third Thursday and looked about the room for Oliver Greswold. He had drawn blank upon both previous occasions, and Mary had told him that although Mr. Greswold was expected, he might be unable to be there. He had so much to do for Lord Hilliard in the East End, and he had his own schemes, working men's night schools, debating societies, endless work. The third Thursday was an occasion of peculiar brilliancy. Mrs. Smith had secured one of the largest stars who could be wheedled into performing for friendship's sake, and had sent little notes to all her friends with the promise of fine music. And this time Mary had something more definite to tell in answer to Arnold's inquiry. "Mr. Greswold can't be here tonight," she said. "His grandfather is dead, at last, and he has come into an immense fortune."
"Oh, his grandfather is dead?"
"He died last week, after keeping that poor young man in subjection and almost poverty all these years. He might have been making a great name in politics instead of wasting his talents upon workmen and night schools.
And now I suppose he will cut the workmen."
"That's very unlikely. He is steeped in all the Hilliard ideas, and is a socialist at heart. He will go into Parliament, of course, and will fight for the cause. And I suppose he will marry Lady Violet, who adores him."
"Is the fortune very large?"
"Nobody knows anything about it yet. At least, Ida Borrowdale doesn't, and you see she is my friend. I am not intimate with Lady Violet, though she and her father came to one of Mrs. Tressilian Smith's parties."
Mary and her chaperone were going to Suffolk next day to spend a month at the Briary, while Dr. Tressilian Smith handed over his patients to his partner and went to Connemara to fish. Of course, all his best patients would be away, and his partner was quite capable of looking after the small fry. Arnold had spent three evenings in Mary's society and had been happy. Indeed, it seemed to him that they had both been happy, and that there was a thrill of joy in Mary's voice when she talked to him. But no word of love had been spoken. He told himself, even, that he had only accepted Mrs. Smith's invitation on the chance of meeting Greswold in her house, that he would not have been so weak as to go there for Mary's sake. But being there, he had spent the evening in Mary's pocket, as his hostess playfully told him. He had set a stern watch upon himself, and had breathed no word of love, nor the slightest allusion to a future in which they too might be one. He was much lighter in heart and spirits for the thought that Mary had ceased to think evil of him, but he was resolute in keeping aloof from all questions of love and marriage. End of chapter 14. Chapter 15 of Rough Justice. This is the LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain.
For more information, or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 15. Mr. Faunce continues. My advertisement resulted successfully, and, as I might reasonably have anticipated, the answer to my inquiry in the Viennese papers came to me from London. Germans of that class find their way to London as if by a natural law of gravitation. Fräulein Noack was now engaged as nurse in a family at South Kensington. A friend had sent her my advertisement, and she begged to be informed whether money had been left her, and if so, how much, and would the advertiser send her something on account of such legacy. In replying to the Fräulein, I begged to inform her that there was no legacy, but that if she would call upon me at my house in Putney, she would be handsomely rewarded for any information she could give me about the person called Lisa, to whom she once gave a Lutheran testament. My letter brought Fräulein Noack within 24 hours. It was my afternoon out, she said, so if I hadn't come today, I couldn't have come for a week. She was a plain, practical young woman, and has mastered the English language, which she speaks with an Austrian accent. She is evidently one of those conscientious persons who, being engaged to teach their charges German, direct their principal efforts to making their pupils teach them English. And it is an open question whether the pupils are not better off without the kind of German Fräulein Noack would impart to them. Did she remember the girl to whom she gave the book? Yes, she remembered her perfectly. They had lived in the same house. What did I want to know, and what reward would I give her if she told me all she could recall about her friend? I mentioned a sovereign, but she smiled ironically, and said that if she had known I was so generous, she would have spent the afternoon with a friend at Earl's Court Exhibition, and would not have wasted her time coming to Putney. Finally, I closed with her for a £5 note, to be paid in advance. "There is your money, gracious lady," handing her the cash. "And now for your information, which in all probability will not be worth 5 shillings. "That makes nothing," replied the damsel. "You wouldn't have advertised for me in 4 newspapers if you were not very anxious to get hold of me." She proceeded to tell him how and when she had made the acquaintance of the girl to whom she had presented the little black book. Lottchen Noack had been a servant in a lodging-house in Vienna when Lisa came to lodge there with her father, whom Lottchen described as a fine-looking man, but a man who had spoilt his health and his appearance by hard drinking. She believed that he was a gambler as well as a drunkard, and that he spent his evenings in low gambling saloons, some of the vilest dens in Vienna. Her master had told her so, and she knew that she herself used to hear his unsteady footsteps stumbling up to his garret in the early morning hours. During the first half-year of his residence, he had occupied good rooms on the 4th floor, but towards the last he had moved to 3 wretched rooms in the roof, and it had been difficult to get even the reduced rent from him. When he first came to the house, Lisa was only 16, very pretty, very winning, and very cruelly treated by her father, who left her in solitude day after day and night after night, and when he was at home would send her on errands all over the city, although she was much too pretty to be trusted alone in such a place as Vienna. "If I hadn't talked to her sometimes, she would have had no one to speak to," said Lottchen. "I don't think she had ever known what it was to be happy. Her father and mother wandered from place to place till the mother was too ill to move, and in that last long illness her father left her alone with the dying mother in a lodging at Havre, where they had scarcely bread to eat, and where the mother had to be buried at the expense of the state, like a pauper. And her mother told her that she had left a luxurious home and forfeited a great fortune for love of a man who had deserted her. He came back a week after the funeral, Lisa told her friend,
paid the people at the lodgings, and carried Lisa off with him. He seemed to have plenty of money at this time, and he came straight to Vienna, and took the nice apartments on the fourth floor, and lived like a gentleman, but was always equally dissipated, stopping out late at nights, and coming home the worse for liquor. When Lisa described those sad days by her mother's deathbed, Lottchen discovered that she had been brought up like a heathen. No one had ever taken her to church, or taught her to believe in God. Her father and mother had quarrelled dreadfully, she confided to Lottchen, after she had known her some time. She had loved her mother dearly, but she had also feared her, for when she was angry, her temper was terrible. She was always complaining of her miserable life, and regretting that she had thrown herself away upon a scoundrel. Many a dinner that they three ate together had been watered with tears. The man was English, but spoke French and German with perfect facility. His name was Clissold. Lottchen took Lisa to the Lutheran church occasionally upon a Sunday evening, when she, the household drudge, was allowed to go. She talked to her of religion, and gave her the little book now in my keeping. As time went on, Lisa altered, and became silent and reserved, and on several occasions Lottchen found her in tears. She was not surprised at this, as the girl's life grew more wretched every day, the father sinking deeper in debauchery, and growing rougher and crueler to his daughter with every downward step. I was not surprised when I heard him storming and raging one morning. It was past 11 o'clock, the hour at which his daughter used to take him his coffee, he sprawling in his bed sometimes till 2 or 3 in the afternoon. He came down to the kitchen in his shirt and trousers with bare feet. He had a letter in his hand, a letter of one sentence which he found in Lisa's garret, where he went to scold her for not waiting upon him. "I have gone away with someone who will treat me kindly." That was all the letter. He was furious. If he had been the best of fathers, he could not have used more dreadful language. He was deep in debt to the landlord, who lost temper with him, hearing the vile things he said to that poor child, and turned him out of the house on the spot, Gleich. "Did you ever hear what became of him?" I asked. "Oh, we heard safe enough, but not for 3 months afterwards. A body was found in the canal, and my master thought the description fitted his old lodger, and went and looked at him. It was Mr. Clissold. He had stones in his pocket, heavy stones, and had meant nothing less than to be drowned." I ask if this was the end of the history, if no inquiries about these people had ever been made of her master. No, there had been no inquiries so long as she lived in the house, which was more than a year after Clissold's death. She had no idea as to the person who took Lisa away. She had never been shown a letter, or a present, or any token of a lover in the background, nor had she ever heard from the girl after she left. She had never gone out walking with Lisa except on a Sunday evening. They kept her too hard at work in the lodging-house. When she left, it had been to go to Paris with a lady, and in her service she had learnt a great deal, and she was now head nurse at South Kensington, with an under-nurse to wait upon her. I took down the address of the lodging-house, and I felt that my next inquiries must be made in Vienna. The only thing to be done there would be to identify Clissold as the man who eloped with old Greswold's daughter. But who could tell, even if he were the man, how many aliases he may have assumed, and how difficult it might be to trace the stages of his downhill career. Clissold. There is some association with that name which I cannot for a moment recall. Was it in connection with the great Burford forgery case 30 years ago that the name occurred? Possibly, for the old butler at Clapham said the lover was a toff, and there were several toffs concerned in the Burford forgeries, directly and indirectly. I must take my evening stroll to Clapham, and have some further talk with my friend Ludgater. I found Ludgater at his usual post in the parlour of the Flower Pot, and in a state of suppressed excitement. He had been told nothing about his master's will, the old man's solicitor had arrived upon the scene within a few hours of his death. He had seldom appeared at the Belvedere of late years, but Ludgater remembered his father, Morris Mortimer Sr., coming there three or four times at very short intervals 9 or 10 years ago, and that on these occasions client and lawyer were closeted together for a considerable time. Ludgater had noticed that Mortimer's visits always occurred during young Greswold's absence. He remembered also that on the last of these visits the lawyer was accompanied by his clerk. "I suspected the old man was plotting against his grandson," he said, "and that the clerk might have come to witness a will that would leave Mr. Oliver out in the cold." The solicitor is one Morris Mortimer, a Jew, whose father was concerned with old Greswold in many of his money-lending schemes. In a word, a fellow bloodsucker. I know a good deal about this Morris. The Mortimer is an addition which his father assumed when he moved his offices westwards and set up his brougham, and I know him to be clever and unscrupulous. The father died 3 years ago. Mr. Mortimer spent some time with Oliver Greswold, looking through the old man's papers, and went away without imparting any information to Ludgater, not even to the effect that he would be provided for in his old age, which he considered hard treatment after so many years of faithful service. I ask if Oliver Greswold looked like a man who had come into a large fortune. If a great fortune made a man very anxious, perhaps he did. Certainly, in Ludgater's opinion, Mr. Oliver looked eaten up with anxiety. He had condescended so far as to tell Ludgater that he and Mr. Mortimer were sole executors, and that the management of the estate would come upon him. It was a very complicated kind of property, for besides investing in all manner of stocks and shares, English and foreign, Mr. Greswold had put a good deal of money into freehold houses in Lambeth and Southwark, and in East London, houses that had brought him in 20% and upwards, but which it was a misery to live in. And yet tenants were eager to get lodgings in them, and would go on suffering and grumbling and suffering for a lifetime. Ludgater had been round among the Lambeth tenants once, when the collector was ill, and he had seen the kind of den that brought old Greswold a dirty canvas bag of silver every week. "There was a dozen such bags brought to him of a Monday night," said Ludgater, "and the old man would sit at his dinner table and count the dirty silver, as if it was all he had to depend upon. But I knew he had money in almost every railway in England, and shares in other things that paid better than railways. Once I ventured to drop the hint that he was wasting his life and caring too much for money. He wasn't a bit offended, but he looks me full in the face very serious and says, 'It isn't that I care so much for money as that I don't care for anything else. That's where the harm is,' he says." After my interview with the old butler, I felt more immediately interested in the Greswold succession and in Oliver Greswold's proceedings than in following up the information I had obtained from Lottchen Noack. I might follow up that clue personally later on. In the meantime, I knew of a very clever member of the Viennese police to whom I could depute the investigation. He had to find out the man Clissold's antecedents for me, if he could. The man must have had associates in Vienna, and from one of these my friend might obtain some particulars of his past life, and carry the retrospective scent to a point at which I could pick up the line. I waited a week before going back to the flower pot, and I found Ludgater in much better spirits. Mr. Greswold had told him that although there were no legacies or specific provision left for any member of the household, he, Ludgater, would be provided for. "I take that upon myself," he said, "and will allow you £100 a year to be paid quarterly by Mr. Mortimer as long as you live. And you can consider yourself your own master, and can live where you please." Ludgater opined that there was only one place in which life would be possible for him, and that would be within 10 minutes' walk of the flower pot. He had seen an unfurnished parlour room in one of the terraces diverging from the Clapham Road, which would suit him, in the house of a highly respectable spinster who had been cook in a good family and might be relied upon to cater and cook for Mr. Ludgater. He opined also that there were various trifles of disused furniture at the Belvedere which would suffice to furnish these two rooms comfortably. He would be sorry to retire from service in the prime of life. He must have been well over 70, and feeling himself as fit to conduct a household as he had been when a young man. But he believed that Mr. Oliver meant to dispose of the Belvedere and to take a house at the west end of London. Ludgater's good humour enabled me to realise a desire that I had vainly tried to gratify during the old man's life. I wanted to see the house and grounds in which Oliver Greswold's dreary boyhood and youth had been spent, and on repeating this request, refused hitherto, Ludgater promised to oblige me if I would call at the Belvedere at noon next day. His young master always left home after an early breakfast, and rarely returned until late in the evening, and we should have the place to ourselves at that hour. Up to this point I had felt myself to blame for not having hunted up any evidence of the young man's habits and disposition which might be afforded by the rooms he had lived in, and upon which every man leaves some imprint of character and temperament. The clue afforded by such indications might be of the slightest, or there might be no clue. But it would be a fault in me to neglect the opportunity. With Ludgater at my side babbling prosily of the days that were no more, I explored the Belvedere from cellar to garret, exhibiting a taste for architecture and old furniture which was, I confess, only an assumption of the moment and a part of the many-sidedness which is essential in my profession. The prosier the old servant was, the more leisure I had for my investigation. The house told me nothing, except that it had once been a stately mansion, built in a day when houses were built to last. Oliver Greswold's rooms were as cold and cheerless as a prison cell. No fancy goods in the way of pipes and cigar boxes, no photographs of pretty actresses, none of the incongruous rubbish to be found in most young men's rooms, but a rigid order in the arrangement of books and papers, which recalled Mr. Durfin's description of the lodger on the second floor in Dynevor Street. The rooms told me only what I already knew about Oliver Greswold, a man of mathematical precision and a fixed purpose, a character of unwavering force for good or for evil. Having surveyed the house, Ludgater invited me to see the garden. Now the garden was not likely to tell me anything about Greswold, who was not at all the kind of man to be fond of a garden, or to devote his leisure to budding roses or training carnations. But it is a precept in my calling that there is no such thing as a negligible quantity, and I followed Ludgater along the moss-grown gravel walks through grounds which had been neglected for a quarter of a century, and where there remained only the rough indications of what had once been a fine suburban garden, such as the citizens of 50 years ago loved. It was in a remote part of the grounds, quite out of view of the house, that I found something which at once aroused my curiosity. There is a short avenue of limes inside the high boundary wall, and here, in walking almost ankle-deep in dead leaves, I kicked up an old playing card, which, even before I stooped to pick it up, I saw had been used as a target. It was riddled with bullet holes. There is an old Lombardy poplar at the end of the avenue, between the last two limes and hiding the return wall. I went over to look at this tree, and, as I expected, found the trunk had served as a mark for a shooter. I found a second playing card, and torn scraps of others in the leaves and rubbish at the foot of the tree. "Mr. Oliver's morning amusement some time ago," said Ludgater. "He ain't had much chance of sport, but he must be uncommon fond of shooting, for he used to be at it of an October morning the year before last, almost as soon as it was light, peppering that poor old tree. It was too far from the house for his grandfather to hear him, or he dursn't have done it.
and there ain't no neighbours on this side of the grounds. But I comes upon him unawares one morning when I was smoking my after-breakfast pipe. He just laughed it off when I expresses my surprise. "Don't think me a fool, old chap," said he. "You see, I have some pals I meet now and then at the West End Shooting Gallery who think no end of themselves, and I want to show them I'm not quite such a duffer as I look." "Well, Mr. Oliver," I says, "I don't see the fun of shooting if you haven't a hannibal to it."
My friend Ludgater is irresolute in the use of aspirates, but I don't often trouble to reproduce his vernacular in this record.
I went home to an early dinner at Putney, pleased with my morning's experience. I had found another link in the chain of evidence leading up to a moral certainty, if not to a case for a jury. In the October before last, Oliver Greswold was shooting at a mark in a quiet corner of his grandfather's garden, and in the following November the sergeant on the northwestern side of Regent's Park saw the skulking figure in the shadow of the porch taking aim at his intended victim. A chance shot in the midnight street would have been a much less audacious crime than the murder in the Bloomsbury lodging-house, and I take it that in crime Mr. Greswold is the kind of man politicians call an opportunist. Before parting company with Ludgater, I contrived to bring the conversation round to the elopement of old Greswold's daughter, and ask in a casual way if he had recalled the name of her aristocratic suitor, a name which he had happened to have forgotten when we last spoke of her. No, he had forgotten the man's name years and years ago. He was a younger son of a nobleman with whom Greswold had done business, a nobleman who kept racehorses and had gone altogether to the bad and been sold up before Greswold came to Clapham. The young man had not been at the Belvedere often. Ludgater believed that Miss Greswold had met him at the house of a widow lady up the river, at Maidenhead or thereabouts, with whom she used to stay for a week at a time. He had heard her father reproaching her for encouraging a worthless fellow without a sixpence, and with one of the worst names among young men in London. One day when the widow lady, whose name also Ludgater had forgotten, came to the Belvedere, there had been a row between her and Greswold, and his master had told him that she was never to be let into the house again. That was all that Ludgater could tell me about the young lady and her lover. There was no more to be done but wait patiently for the report from Vienna and for an inspection of old Greswold's will, which I meant to see at the earliest opportunity. The report from Vienna came to hand after a fortnight's delay, during which my friend Wildover favoured me with several visits and exhibited all the indications of a temperament better adapted to camp life in South Africa than in keeping quiet and playing a waiting game in London. He had seen something of Greswold in the interval, having met him twice at Mr. Borrowdale's in Russell Square, where there were frequent meetings of a little knot of philanthropists headed by Lord Hilliard. There was a grand scheme in hand for a philanthropic factory with dormitories and a public eating-room all under one roof, an adaptation on a smaller and more domestic scale of Louis Blanc's National Workshops, one of those brilliant schemes which usually end in failure. "The fellow passes for a saint with Lord Hilliard and his set," Wildover said savagely. "They are all deluded by his high head and melodious voice. They don't notice his hard, thin lips and stealthy eye, an eye that looks slowly round the room and inquires, 'Is there anyone here who suspects me? Is there anyone here who sees the man behind the mask?' I sit and watch him like a tiger waiting to spring. When shall I be able to take the leap, Faunce? I long to have my claws in his throat." "I'm afraid you'll have to crouch a good deal longer," said I. The news from Vienna brought very little information about Clissold's antecedents, but my colleague's letter contained one significant fact. He had discovered that he was not the first inquirer upon Clissold's track. A Parisian detective had been in Vienna a year before, making careful inquiries about this very Clissold, whom he had traced from Paris. Andrew Greswold's will was proved without loss of time, and I took an early opportunity of reading it. It was neither long nor complicated. He left his entire estate, real and personal, to his granddaughter Lilian Carford, born in Paris on June the 6th, 1865, and christened at the Protestant church in the Rue Saint-Honoré, chargeable with an annuity of $600 a year to his grandson Oliver Greswold. In the event of his granddaughter's predeceasing him, the estate was to go to his grandson Oliver. I make this disposition of my property with no ill feeling towards my grandson, who has been obedient and dutiful to me. But as I was a cruel father to a daughter whom I loved better than any other human being, I make this atonement to her daughter, should she survive me. I make no bequest to charities, for the simple reason that I have been pestered by the innumerable appeals of charity mongers until the very look of a subscription list has become hateful to me. An eccentric will, yet there was nothing in the wording of it to show that the testator was not thoroughly competent to dispose of his property. It was executed 10 years before the death of the testator. It was witnessed by James Howell, clerk, and Morris Mortimer, Sr., solicitor of Albemarle Street, Morris, Jr. being appointed joint executor with Oliver Greswold. Lilian Carford, Lisa Clissold. The initials were the same, but that was a trifling coincidence to the mind of a man experienced in meaningless coincidences. "There is your motive for murder, a great fortune at stake," cried Wildover, when I showed him my copy of the will. "The difference between affluence and a pittance, between wealth that will enable him to marry the woman he loves, to shine in Parliament, to accomplish every desire of his eager, ambitious nature, and a beggarly $600 a year. You were right, Faunce. There was a life to be suppressed, an unoffending woman to be cheated out of her inheritance, and by the straightest way, murder. I know the man. I have watched him. He is burnt through and through with the fire of ambition. He is all nerve and brain. In Robespierre's place, he would have sacrificed as many lives as Robespierre sacrificed, and would have called himself an honest man. Do you suppose such a man would stick at one life? He would murder me tomorrow if he thought I suspected him. We are sure of nothing yet. Yes, we are, of the motive, the man, everything. Lilian Carford. Lilian. My God, I remember her once asking me if I thought Lilian a prettier name than Lisa. I laughed at her for asking such a childish question. That was in our best days, when I was flush of money and we were light-hearted enough to talk nonsense. The granddaughter's age would correspond with hers. She told me that she was 24 just before I sailed for the Cape. I let him rave as long as he liked in his impetuous way, but I reminded him at last that until we could establish the identity of the murdered woman with Andrew Greswold's heiress, our chain of evidence wanted the most important link. An advertisement inquiring for Lilian Carford, or for any information as to the present whereabouts, if living, or to the date and place of her death, if dead, appeared in the Times daily for a week, and on alternate days for a month. The address given was that of W. Morris Mortimer, solicitor, Albemarle Street, W. I had some thoughts of calling upon Mr. Morris Mortimer in relation to this advertisement. It would have been easy to pretend an acquaintance with some young woman called Carford, who might or might not be the person wanted, and of whom I should have conveniently lost sight some years previously. But I doubted if this process would enable me to screw any information out of so artful a card as Morris Mortimer, who might happen to be acquainted with my personal appearance, and it would at once be put on his guard. My client's interests demanded the closest secrecy, and any suspicion of any inquiry would make our progress all the more difficult. I have interviewed the gunsmith's assistant who sold the pistol, and he has promised to assist in the identification of the purchaser if I can bring him where he can see the suspected person, though he cannot at the present hour recall the face of the man we want. The face might come back to him, he thinks, if he were to see the man.
My plan is to take him to the next public meeting at which Greswold appears as a speaker. He has accepted a little present in advance for his trouble and loss of time, and I think I have secured silence and secrecy on his part. I have only to wait my opportunity for putting his memory to the test. End of chapter 15. Chapter 16 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 16. Waiting on Fortune. Time wore on, and Arnold saw life full of joys, emotions, and movement for Wilmot and his Ida, who were to be married early in the coming year. While for him, life was like a stagnant pool in tropical Africa, across which never a ripple breaks, save when the dark bulk of a crocodile stirs below the slimy waters. Arnold longed for movement on the part of that one crocodile that lay like a log at the bottom of his life pool. He had to stand aside and bide his time while Oliver Greswold was realizing all the ambitions of his eager temperament. He had sprung at a bound into social importance. 6 months ago he had been known only as a clever young man, dependent for his daily bread upon a miserly grandfather, and shining in the reflected light of Lord Hilliard's patronage, able to help his lordship's schemes with his brains and his voice, but making no figure in the subscription lists where his patron's name shone conspicuous. He was now known as a man of much larger means than Lord Hilliard had ever possessed, even before he began to impoverish himself for the benefit of his fellow creatures. The public voice, or rather the voice of that small public which knew Oliver Greswold, exaggerated the amount of his fortune, and the young philanthropist and orator was now listened to with a new interest at drawing-room meetings as a reputed millionaire, while his attachment to Lady Violet was dwelt upon as the most romantic thing in modern history. He bore his prosperity with a good grace, and for the half-year immediately following his grandfather's death, he spoke of himself deprecatingly as only a custodian of the property, and refrained from exercising any of the rights of an owner, even in the way of improvement. "Every possible means is being taken to find my cousin, if she is living," he told Lord Hilliard, who had lately been made acquainted with his secretary's hopes, and was warmly interested in his fortunes. "My solicitor and co-executor cabled to America and the colonies, and advertisements have been appearing all over Australia and the United States, in Canada, South America, and the West Indies, and in a large number of continental papers. We have spent hundreds upon advertising." "And without result?" "With the result of producing 20 or 30 claimants, regular Miss Ortons, not one of whom knew my grandfather's name, or where she, the claimant, was born, or her mother's name, or could oblige us with a certificate of her baptism. In most cases, the church where Miss Orton was christened was supposed to have been burnt down, and the registers had perished in the flames. There has been a perennial supply of Lillian Carfords since we began to advertise." "And you think your cousin must be dead?" "I won't say I fear so. I should be a hypocrite if I pretended not to want this fortune. I do want it, and I believe I have a higher claim upon it than my cousin, and that only sheer perversity upon my grandfather's part would have left it away from me." "Remorse, perhaps, rather than perversity," suggested Lord Hilliard. "Remorse, yes, if the daughter he had cast off had been living, and he could have atoned for years of neglect, years in which he let her starve and perish. But she, being gone,
What had remorse to do with the granddaughter he had never seen, the offspring of a man he detested? I have my own theory about my grandfather, Lord Hilliard, which I would not breathe to anybody but you. I believe that from the day of his daughter's elopement the balance of his mind was gone. He was keen enough in business, perfectly able to look after a very complicated mass of property, and to make sure that no man cheated him of a shilling. But I think from that time he was what we call a crank. His whole manner of living was that of a monomaniac, taking into account the extent of his means, and the self-indulgent life he had led previously. He ground the faces of the poor in order to pile up money, which he left reluctantly, first to his granddaughter, and then to me. It was the merest hazard that he didn't leave it all to a hospital. Did he ever tell you he meant to make a will in your cousin's favor? Never. The will was 10 years old. I dare say it pleased him to know the surprise he had in store for me. I don't want to speak of him unkindly. He is in his grave, and I am likely to profit by his long life of money-grubbing and deprivation. But I cannot forget that in all those years he never gave me a word of praise or a sign of affection. He seemed almost irritated with me for coming out in the honor list at Cambridge. He had never heard of a senior wrangler doing much good in the world, he told me, and he supposed there were plenty of seventh wranglers breaking stones in Australia. I was seventh on the list, and I thought he might have flung me a kind word when I went back to Clapham. I had kept rigidly within my allowance, and had been content to keep aloof from all the most popular men of my year, and to rank as a smug, the worst possible kind of smug in some men's opinion, the smug who reads hard and never misses a lecture. You have had a hard youth, Greswold, but you will now, if this young woman is dead, have grand opportunities, a magnificent career. With Lord Hilliard, a magnificent career meant a life devoted to picking the fallen out of the mire and setting weaklings upon their legs, to looking after the health and morals of the working man, to remodeling the dwellings of those who could not afford to pay sanitary engineers or provide scientific ventilation on their own account. Self-abnegation had become as natural to Lord Hilliard as self-indulgence is to most people. End of chapter 16.
Chapter 17 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 17, For the Happiness of the Greatest Number. Oliver Greswold's first act of ownership in the beginning of the new year was the demolition of some of the most profitable house property in his grandfather's rent roll. They had been among the worst houses of the London poor and had yielded from 10 to 20% to their owner. When rebuilt, they were to be among the best and healthiest dwellings open to the working classes, and they would yield their owner at most 2.5%, with a very moderate margin for repairs. "People can afford to hold land that pays them less," Oliver told Lady Violet. "I have no broad acres to be proud of. I want to be proud of my acres of humanity, my great piles of human life, rising story above story into the clearer air, in airy rooms and spacious corridors, sweet and clean from basement to garret." He and Lady Violet had planned the houses with the assistance of an architect who, to Violet's eager mind, seemed very inferior to Oliver in the constructive arts, but who did occasionally throw in a staircase or a chimney shaft which they would have omitted, and who sometimes showed a glimmer of intelligence in the arrangement of fireplaces and windows. Oliver and his sweetheart were so full of architectural ideas, mostly impracticable, that the professional mind seemed narrow and limited in comparison. Life and the future smiled upon the philanthropist with a new brightness. He was Violet's acknowledged suitor, and they were to be married soon after Ida and Wilmot. A fine old Georgian house in a park of 300 acres within 10 miles of Lord Hildyard's Yorkshire seat had been in the market for the last half dozen years, had been put up for sale twice during that time at a great auction mart in the city of London, and had drawn down the scathing reprobation of a famous auctioneer who told the room it didn't know how to bid for a good thing when it was offered. Twice had the estate, some 900 acres in all, been offered to the British public, and twice withdrawn, and many an attempted private treaty had fallen through, and now from a despairing owner, banished by chronic asthma and chronic poverty from his native soil, Oliver Greswold bought the property for about half the first reserve price which the proud possessor had set upon it when his courage was high. Wilverwold Park was a fine old English home. The gardens were spacious and had been established for the best part of 2 centuries. The house had been built and finished while the first George was a stranger in England, and while the English people were still wondering at his strange taste and beauty, as exemplified by his 2 German mistresses, the fat and the thin. Thick walls, narrow windows, large reception rooms with lofty ceilings, a fine hall paved with black and white marble, a carved oak staircase, and a lantern roof were things for a young wife to be proud of, and Lady Violet was very proud of her future home, having known and admired Wilverwold from her childhood, preferring that sober red-brick mansion to the mock Italian villa which her grandfather had built when Lord Liverpool was minister, and which had all the faults common to the ugliest period in domestic architecture: a heavy portico, darkening hall and dining room, a low slate roof, impertinent columns and meaningless balustrades, dog-hole bedrooms and reception rooms whose lofty spaciousness sent away every unacclimatized guest with a cold in the head. Mr. Greswold had bought Wilverwold House with all its belongings, and amongst the furniture sold by the dispirited proprietor en bloc, there were pieces of Sheraton and Chippendale cabinet work, treasures of old Chinese black and gold screens which would have fetched high prices if offered at Christie's. In a blind ignorance, having failed to get a good price for the land, he overrated Sir Henry Knowlhurst of Wilverwold, let his furniture go upon the valuation of a provincial upholsterer, who told him the things were shabby and out of date. "Quite out of date, Sir Henry, and you're very lucky to get 'em off your hands." There was very little to wait for at Wilverwold. Oliver Greswold sent down 3 chests of plate that had been lying at the bank ever since his grandfather turned anchorite. 12 spoons and forks and a tea service had been enough for the 2 men in a house where a visitor was as rare an event as a thunderstorm. The Morris Mortimers, father and son, and the sour-visaged nonconformist parson were almost the only visitors Oliver had ever seen in that gloomy dining-room. But now all the treasures that had been hoarded in the dark were to come out into the sunshine, and were to belong to Violet and her husband. The house at Wilverwold was being got ready for them. They were often in Russell Square, and Arnold, who had been accepted by Ida as her sweetheart's adopted brother, frequently met them there. Oliver was always civil to him, civil and indifferent, worlds away from guessing his identity with the man from Africa who had been arrested as Lisa Rayner's murderer. He must have kept aloof from the police court when the inquiry was going on, or he would have remembered the face of the man in the dock, Arnold thought, and this very fact that Greswold had not once looked in at the court during the twice adjourned inquiry might seem evidence in his favor. Would not anxiety have taken him there almost in spite of himself, had he been guilty? No, to have shown himself there ever so briefly would have been an imprudence, and this man was caution personified. He was less cautious now, perhaps, having prejudged Arnold as a good-natured oaf incapable of far-reaching suspicions. He went so far as to betray an interest in the half-forgotten Bloomsbury murder by asking Arnold if he had ever met the man Wildover in Africa. "Yes," Arnold confessed to having known the man. "What kind of fellow was he?" Greswold asked carelessly. "The kind of fellow who would be incapable of cold-blooded murder." "Oh, then you think he was innocent?" "I am sure he was. Do you suppose he was guilty?" "Oh, I have never thought about him. I remember thinking the case looked rather black, but I have forgotten all details except that the man hailed from South Africa. Do you know if he went back there?" "If he was wise, he would get out of England. And I suppose among you gold and diamond diggers he would be thought none the worse of for an escapade of that kind. For killing a woman in cold blood because she stood in his way?" "Because she stood in his way?" repeated Greswold. "Yes, I take it that must have been the motive. Only if it was the man from Africa, he might have wanted to get rid of an importunate mistress, the survival of a past that sickened him. If the murder was done by a stranger, gain, the money that had just been given her, must have been the motive." "I see you do remember the details, after all. They come back to my memory as we talk. It was a problem case, and crime problems are always interesting." "Naturally, one speculates upon the kind of man, and upon his feelings before and after the deed, how much or how little he may suffer. Experience proves that there is a kind of man who doesn't suffer at all." "Perhaps. A great general does not count the lives lost in a battle, though a mistake in tactics may have involved the sacrifice of thousands. I don't suppose Marlborough regretted Malplaquet, though there were a good many people who thought that victory was only another name for needless carnage. I don't suppose a surgeon frets because many of his finest operations have resulted in death, one life more or less in a world where everybody must die. It is not a subject for lifelong remorse. I like your idea of the philosophic assassin who can put the memory of his crime away from him as calmly as a resolute man can forget the friend he has cut. And then a man might be good all round except in that one circumstance of a murder. There are cases, even, in which he might be of more use to his fellow men because of that murder. He might have sinned for the happiness of the greatest number." "That is taking a rather wide view of the criminal question. But men are easier under the burden of crime than you and I, who have not dipped our hands in blood, could imagine. I've seen a good deal of the criminal classes, and I never knew a wife murderer who did not look upon his victim's death as an unlucky accident, a perversity in the power that governs life, rather than a criminal impulse on his part." The two men were standing in the deep embrasure of a window in the Russell Square dining-room, talking together in a friendly way, face to face, while the people who had crowded in to tea after a drawing-room meeting gradually dispersed. Greswold had his cup and saucer in his hand and sipped his tea in the pauses of his talk. Not a flicker of the eyelid, not the faintest quiver of the resolute lips indicated that the conversation was in any way unpleasant to him. His voice, a little fatigued after speaking long and vigorously, had been marked by a calm languor, every syllable uttered deliberately, every word following without break or hesitancy. Never was there less suggestion of suppressed feeling in the manner of a man. Yet only by that cruel mouth Arnold might have known him capable of any act, however desperate, that would help him to realize his ambition, to snatch the happiness for which he longed. His eyes softened as he looked at Lady Violet when she came to him presently with some trivial inquiry, obviously for the sake of being near him. The eyes changed and brightened with the light that told of a passionate love. But the mouth was cruel, even when it smiled. Arnold had no more doubt of his guilt than that the March sunlight was shining upon his face as he stood there. He had made up his mind upon that question even before the motive had revealed itself. Could he doubt now, when one lonely woman's death made all the difference between dependence and wealth? He had seen the power of Greswold's new position today, and how the influence of the popular speaker, the people's advocate, had been quadrupled by the knowledge of his fortune. He had been speaking on behalf of a new rescue society, a society in which all the workers were those who had themselves been among the fallen, who had gone down to the depths and had been saved from deep waters and knew the horror of a vicious life as no virtuous woman can know it. "It is noble, heroic in a chaste woman to go amongst her fallen sisters," he said, "but half the time it is heroism wasted, self-sacrifice in the wrong place. These dear saints don't know what to say to the sinners. The fellow feeling is wanting. Only the bitter experience of sin can teach them the way to their erring sisters' hearts." And then he had drawn a moving picture of the redeemed sinner, no longer young, no longer fair, pleading with youth and beauty, vain, happy, prosperous, tripping with light foot along the primrose path. "We don't want to save them only at the last, when the tempters have ceased to tempt, and the trade in sin is over. We want to startle them in the morning of sin, while the sun shines and their world is full of roses. You ladies can hardly grasp the fact that for these your sisters, vice means a life of pleasure and virtue a life of toil. They were starving in garrets perhaps yesterday, and today they are feasting in fine rooms, wearing fine clothes, driving in the sunshine, caressed, praised, adored perhaps. The only woman who can startle and win them is the woman who can tell them what comes afterwards, can show them that hideous future in the fierce light of her own experience, a woman who is not afraid to speak such words as you ladies have never heard and could not utter even if you knew them. Sex to sex, sister to sister, it is the fallen who must rescue the fallen." There had been tears in his voice, and many of his hearers had been moved to tears, and the women present had responded liberally to his appeal for the help they could give: money, clothes, books, furniture, flowers, for this spacious and comfortable old house in a remote northeast suburb which he was about to open as the house of Mary Magdalene. It was among the many small properties in the neighborhood of London which Andrew Greswold had acquired in the course of his practice as a money-lending solicitor. Every square foot of the five-acre garden and paddock was now a gold-bearing soil, and would have been promptly taken up by the speculative builder to blossom into terraces and squares for the lower middle class, a class seemingly infinite. Mr. Greswold's generosity in devoting ground so valuable to the uses of charity had been praised and wondered at, but he had put aside all such praises lightly. To be of real use, the house of Mary Magdalene must be within half an hour's drive of central London, he said. When a brand has to be snatched from the burning, there must be no question of a journey to some remote village, no long waiting at a railway station affording time to repent of repentance. Rescue work must be prompt and instant. In the wicked London streets, an outcast and a wanderer at midnight, in the home, sheltered, protected, on the threshold of a new life before morning. This house of Mary Magdalene was only one among many gifts which marked Oliver Greswold's succession to the wealth that had so long been growing with compound interest in the miser's keeping, sometimes lying dormant in some sluggish 3% debentures, sometimes speculated with a reckless daring, but with a foreknowledge, a flair, which realized cent per cent. The game of money had been Andrew Greswold's only recreation in all those long years after his retirement from the law. He had played with his capital with the resolute, far-seeing play with which the proficient plays a fine hand at whist. In all that bold handling of an ever-growing capital, there had not been one generous use of wealth, nor had the money-grubber's narrow mind ever conceived the idea of wealth as a means to charitable deeds. No pang of remorse had troubled him in the slow decay of a vigorous old age. If he had left his fortune to a hospital, the motive would have been of the basest, the wish to disappoint an expectant heir. Arnold Wentworth pondered long and deeply upon the problem of Oliver Greswold's nature, believing as he did believe that this wonder-working philanthropist, whose pleading for sinners could move strong men to tears, was himself a sinner, and the vilest of sinners. He asked himself whether it was possible that such a man could have benevolent instincts, a warm, active humanity, keenly alive to the sorrows and sufferings of others. Could love of the race be compatible with inexorable cruelty to the individual? Could any sane man persuade himself that the murder of a helpless woman, his kinswoman, who had never injured him, was to be justified by the noble uses he could make of a fortune secured by blood? Remembering that conversation in the embrasure of the window, when for the first time he had discussed the ethics of crime with this suspected murderer, it seemed to him possible that Oliver Greswold had persuaded himself that such a crime might be justified by its results. He recalled that allusion to Malplaquet, a battle so recklessly hazarded, so disastrous a victory, and he remembered that the great captain, who could risk the slaughter of thousands in order to hold his supremacy as a commander, had been the fondest, the most devoted of husbands to a termagant wife. These contradictions and inconsistencies are the stuff of which human nature is woven, a woof of darkness, a warp of light, black and silver threads crossing and recrossing. It came within the limits of possibility that this bold sinner was not the despicable hypocrite he had seemed to Arnold in the first instance. And this man was to marry a woman who loved him with the generous confidence of youth that knows not the meaning of falsehood or sin. It was impossible to see Lady Violet and her lover together, or to hear her talk of him in his absence, without discovering that to her he was saint-like, godlike, a being as worthy of worship as of love, and to be very sure that for this woman disillusion would mean death. The blow might not destroy that fine frame in the perfection of healthy girlhood, but it would take all the joy out of the young life. The heart would break, and perhaps brokenly live on. Arnold Wentworth had not the courage to interpose between Violet and her lover, to try to prevent a marriage that seemed sacrilege, considering the spotless innocence of the bride, the awful guilt of the husband. Faunce had warned him that the chain of circumstantial evidence might snap at any point and prove Greswold to be the victim of a series of curious coincidences. No, he could not say to Violet, "The man you love is a villain," unless he had stronger proof of Greswold's guilt than that which he had himself accepted as conclusive. Events must take their natural course, and as Oliver's wife Violet would only stand in the place of a woman who has loved a scoundrel, and who, having once loved him, would rather mate herself with the darkest consequences of crime than forsake a repentant sinner. Violet and Ida had been almost inseparable since the two weddings had been fixed. The useful horse that drew Lady Violet's light Victoria knew all the turnings between Hyde Park Gardens and Russell Square, and could with difficulty be persuaded to take any other direction. There was much less talk about trousseau and wedding pageantry than there usually is between young women at such a time. Lady Violet had been brought up in the ways of self-abnegation, and had been taught to think of what she owed to other people, and never of what was due to herself. She was oppressed with no idea of what society expected at the marriage of Lord Hildyard's daughter. Details, all important, all absorbing to the average bride, were ignored by her. Her father had given her a check for more money than she had ever had before, and had begged her to order all that was needful. "You have no mother, not even a kind aunt, to assist you, Vi," he had said, "but you have plenty of common sense, and I have no doubt you will manage very well." "I really want very few new frocks, father. We are to live in the country, except when we are with you, and tailor gowns last so long." "Oh, but you must be smart, my dear. Our Yorkshire neighbors will be critical about you." "I think they have known me too long to be critical. They would wonder to see your daughter going in for fashion. Don't be frightened, father. I mean to have nice frocks. I want Oliver to be proud of his wife." Ida, though reared in a philanthropic atmosphere, had a shade more worldliness, and was altogether businesslike in her arrangements, taking upon herself the direction and management of every detail upon the ground of Wilmot's incapacity for any business outside a mine. She had pronounced it essential to her happiness that she should live near Violet, and to gratify this wish, Wilmot had explored the country within a 20-mile radius of Wilverwold Park, and had at last succeeded in finding something secluded and uncivilized enough for his South African taste, a house which nobody else would consent to live in, since it stood on the skirts of a moor, 9 miles from a railway station and 5 from church, doctor, and butcher. But the spot was pronounced healthy, and some moorland shooting might be had. With the bride of his choice, guns, dogs, and a horse or two, Wilmot felt he could be completely happy at Lingfield Lodge. Ida looked a little doubtful when he described this gem of a dwelling with a wild garden and a little wood of Scotch firs between garden and moor. But as she had insisted upon living near her dearest friend, and as Lingfield was within 7 miles of Wilverwold, she could hardly withhold her approval. "I should have preferred being close to a dear little town with a nice church and a conscientious old doctor and a few decent people, parson and so on, to drop in to tea. I shall have to ride and cycle and shoot and fish to fill my time, especially as there are no cottagers within a walk for me to look after. Not a roof or a barn within eye range. It must be lonelier than Cornwall or Ireland." "It is, but there are plenty of snipe and plover." Ida Borrowdale and Mary Freeland had grown fast friends in the familiarity of philanthropic gatherings in Russell Square and evening parties at Hexton Gardens, so Mary was to be the second of two bridesmaids, that modest number being the utmost Wilmot could tolerate. He had told his sweetheart that if she or her people organized a fine wedding, he should inevitably run away before the event. "You would have 14 bridesmaids and no bridegroom," he said. "I shouldn't want to do anything so dastardly, but the impulse would be stronger than me. I should bolt. 14 would be preposterous, but 2 will be shabby," Ida answered discontentedly. Happily for Wilmot, Mrs. Borrowdale's bad health was a powerful factor in the domestic arrangements. As a professional invalid, she insisted upon a subdued ceremonial. Everything was to be in half tones. If she were required at the church, there must be no fuss or bustle. She was not sure that her nerves would stand Mendelssohn's noisy march, but of course, if Ida insisted upon it, the march must be played. A crowded reception after the wedding was out of the question. It would be worse than one of those dreadful drawing-room meetings which always brought on her neuralgic pains, even though she was never in the room. The noise of people going up and down stairs made her a perfect wreck for a week afterwards. "I should like to have seen all my friends," Ida murmured. "I shall only be married once, mother." "And you can only kill your mother once, Ida. I don't think you would wish to do that." "Dearest, dearest mother, don't say such dreadful things. The wedding shall be as quiet as you like." "Thank you, my love. That is a weight off my mind. I have been thinking what a trial your wedding would be for my poor nerves ever since you were born." Her wishes being thus complied with, Mrs. Borrowdale acted handsomely in the matter of house linen, and long-hoarded silver was brought out of the strong room in the basement, and Ida felt that in spite of the quiet wedding, she was being launched upon the matrimonial ocean with all due honors. Arnold was his friend's best man, and was thus brought again into Mary Freeland's company. He had avoided all chances of meeting her since her return from Eastbourne. He had not even sent her a Christmas card, she told Ida piteously, forgetting perhaps what a bitter anniversary Christmas was for him, and how the remembrance of that Christmas tragedy in Dynevor Street might shut out all cheerful and gracious thoughts. It had not been so with Arnold, however, for although his memory had been full of that last Christmas Eve and the pathetic interview, his own painful sense of being unkind to a woman who loved him, the tears, the sad parting, the unspeakable horror that came afterwards, there had yet been room in his mind for thoughts of Mary, as he passed the smart shops full of expensive prettiness, where other people were buying gifts for their beloved. He refrained from gift or greeting to his dearest, resolute to stand aloof until he could bring her evidence that would take the stain from his name, the shadow from his life. On the wedding day, it was Mary who held herself aloof, seemingly unconscious of Arnold's existence after the first cold touch of meeting hands. She looked almost as white as her gown and hat, and was not an ideal bridesmaid, her pallid cheeks contrasting strangely with the pink chubbiness of Ida's other friend. Lady Violet and her betrothed were among the few guests, and Arnold was touched with that spectacle of happy love, so free from apprehension upon Violet's part, knowing that it was perhaps his mission to change the cup of joy into a cup of bitterness. "Am I to think of mercy in dealing with a wretch who was merciless, who would have let me suffer on the gallows, and would have gone on his way reaping the harvest of virtue with a soul steeped in blood? No, there can be no question of mercy, no relenting or looking back." End of chapter 17. For the happiness of the greatest number.